بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما. The prayer times are divided into two types. What's called مختار and the other is called ضروري. The مختار prayer time is a convenience time. It's the time that you're given to decide for yourself when to pray. Obviously, the best time to pray during the مختار is the early period, with the exception of Dhuhr. Malik delays Dhuhr because, and the reason he did that is that the Khawarij were obsessed with like praying exactly when the Zawal came. So he didn't like that zealotry, and his madhab delays it. That's one of the reasons. The other is that if you pray in a Maliki country that's following Maliki fiqh, because a lot of these countries don't anymore. So for instance, Morocco does not pray according to the Maliki Dhuhr time anymore. If you go to Morocco, they pray. So one of my sheikhs in Fez told me, تَرَكْنَا الْمَذْهَبِ وَقَلَّدْنَا Greenwich. You know, we left the madhab and now we follow Greenwich. But he, Dhuhr time is to one dira' from the fate. We talked about the fate. Does everybody remember what the fate is? The fate, it's the extra, it's what's ever left over from the zawal. The sun, okay, the sun is rising in the east. The east is over here, west is over here. So the sun's rising. When it rises, you're here, it'll cast a shadow to the east. Now, as it's moving up in the sky, the shadow is getting smaller until it reaches the point where if you're in, because here's the south down here and here's the north up here. We're in a northerly climate, right? Because in the equatorial countries like Sudan, Saudi Arabia, Pakistan, you get periods where the sun gets directly overhead. But if you're further than 26 degrees, then it's not. You're always going to have some leftover because the sun's just not overhead. If you're in a really northerly climate, you're going to get a lot of shadow. So as the sun's coming up, the shadow's getting smaller and smaller. At the point that the sun is literally right over your head, I mean, it might be to the south, or if you're in Australia, it'll be to the north. But it's 90 degrees in terms of the dome of the earth. All right, you have a dome, and 180 degrees is the plane that we're on, because the circle is 360 degrees. So when it hits the 90 degree, that point is called istiwa. That's waqt al-istiwa. And the Arabs describe it as istawat ash-shamsu fi kabd as-sama. The sun is sitting in the liver of the sky, the middle of the sky, kebed. You know, it's the middle, like the liver's in the middle of the body, kebed as-sama. So the sun appears to sit there. The Arabs actually thought that it stopped because the shadow stops. But now we know it doesn't. And I mean, the ulama knew, because Ibn Arafah centuries ago said it only appears to stop. So it's not like the ulama didn't know that, all right? But the simple Arabs thought that it stopped. So they call that istiwa, sitting, because it looked like the sun just sat there. And during that point, so we're here, okay? East, west, south, north. So when the sun rises here, all right, it moves up till it reaches 90 degrees here. This is 0 degrees, this is 180. And then obviously during the nighttime, it's down here. So at like I said, your shadow from here, because of the angle, right, your shadow is going to be cast. But as the sun's moving up, the shadow is getting shorter and shorter and shorter. And then when the shadow hits here at 90 degrees, that extra leftover is called faith. All right, it's called faith. That's the leftover shadow. That is what you will, once in Malik's madhab, you're supposed to see a discernible increase. So there's your faith, that little shadow there. Right now it's 2.5 feet because we measured it. And it's going to stay 2.5 feet for you know, 2 weeks or something. Once you start seeing a discernible move, it'll now you're moving back towards the east. First you were moved, the shadow was moving to the west, then it moves towards the east, so it begins to move this way. So by the time the shadow gets to the fei and then your height, the 7 feet for an average person, that's asr according to Malik. Abu Hanifa goes from there to twice, right? Twice your height. So it would be up to 14, 15, 16 and a half feet would be asr for Abu Hanifa, according to one of the opinions. I mean, there's two opinions in his madhab. So now, to show you the this is the book, by the way, on the Maliki Fiqh, but unfortunately, it was supposed to be out. I was hoping to actually have it for this thing, but. There's no faith twice a year because the sun's moving. So there will be a period of time where there is no faith. It disappears, like in Mecca, twice. Because the sun, if you watch the east, right, the sun, these are called the mashariq in the, right, it's going like this and then back. And it takes the sun a year to do that. So there's a period in the equatorial countries for a couple of months where it's you know, twice a year. It'll be, you know, as it's moving back, right? Because it moves back, right, twice a year. So it'll return to these places. And during that time, the fei disappears. All right? I mean, around the time of the September and June are the June and December are the longest points, right? Because that's the point where it reaches the furthest. June is the furthest north. December 21st is the furthest south. I mean, and then the equinox, which is where it's equal, those are the points during where, if you're in an equatorial country, those are the points where the fate will disappear when it's right overhead, depending on where you are, obviously. So, this, and now what's interesting about the moon, for people that are interested in this, the moon does in a month what the sun does in a year. So most people don't even notice this stuff anymore, but it used to be very important to pre-modern people. So if you watch the moon is actually moving all in 1 month. It'll do that what the sun does in a year. So the moon has risings and settings as well, and they fluctuate also. All right. So if you look now, I did, this was done, I had it done two ways. One is a linear, and the other is circular. So I'll do the linear first. So, this period here is Fajr. Now, the sun, when it reaches 18 according to some, 15 according to others, and there is a difference. 3 degrees is about 12 minutes. So each degree in this 360 degree circle, each degree is about 4 minutes. There's a lag time every day, which is why we get calendrical problems. When you try to make solar calendars, you get problems. Lunar calendars, you don't get a problem because you're following the moon, and so it's going to change every month, right? But when the sun, when you fix it, because the sun actually takes 23 hours and 56 minutes to go all the way around, and this is, you know, it's average, on average. You get that 4 minute lag time. So as that adds up, by the time you've got 4 years, there's a whole day, right? So you get your leap year. But anyway, 15, 18 degrees. Most of the programs you have here are on 18 degrees. And obviously it changes too on where you are on the earth because of the angles. I mean, this is all geometry. So for people that vaguely remember some of that stuff back in high school. Now, the 18 degrees is where the sun is 18 degrees below the horizon, is when you first start seeing the light. Yeah. But the more cautious view is 15 degrees. There's something called Fajr al-Kadhib, which is the lying Fajr, which it appears, you'll see a light. It's a phenomenon. And you'll see a light, you know, again, people are just cut off from this. Artificial light removes this. When I was out in the Sahara, you see it every morning if you're, you know, I mean, they're very connected to all these signs. There's no, you know, they know what day it is without calendars, because of the stars that are on the horizon. Certain stars show up on certain days. This works every year. Mm-hmm.
Does it vary throughout the year, the time difference between the false dawn and
the true? It's going to vary slightly, you know, based on where you are. But it doesn't vary in terms of your location, right? It's just going to vary, because the sun's the same. It's just moving like that. So, you know, Fajr changes. The time of Fajr changes, but the actual phenomenon is based on the degree of where the sun is. So the false dawn is a light that comes up, and it looks like dawn, but it's not. And then that light disappears. And it's they describe it as a foxtail, because it's kind of a, you know, it's not a flat line. It's more like that. So that, you have to wait till that goes. And the books all mention that many people have mistakenly prayed with false dawn, thinking that it was dawn because they saw that light, and that light disappears. So when that light goes, you'll see on the horizon, if you're looking at the horizon, a very white light that's clear, and it should spread all the way across the horizon. And that white light increases quite fast. The best place to see it is on an airplane, because you'll really, if you're traveling in the night where you know you're going to hit Fajr, it's nice to see it, because you'll really, you can watch how that, you'll see the curvature of the earth, and you can watch how that happens. There's pictures of it obviously as well, but it's good to see it, to experience it. So when you see that, that is the beginning of the Fajr time. Now, that period, which is quite dark, will last, which is, you know, that's the beginning of what's called subah prayer. Fajr is the crack of dawn. And literally, you know, fajr means to split. So this idea, the crack of dawn, is a metaphor that the Arabs use as well. And then, basically, you move into, you know, the light begins to increase. Now, this early part is the best part to pray the Fajr in. It's also, that's the khayt al-abyad, حتى يتبين الخيط الأبيض من الخيط الأسود, until you can distinguish the white thread from the black thread. The black thread is the thread above the white. So the, you know, one of the Sahaba was out, he had two white threads, you know, a white thread and a black thread, and he was out, and the Prophet said, asked him what he was doing. He said he was trying to distinguish between the white thread and the black, and he put his head on his back of his head, and he said, "Ya arid al-qafa," you know, because the Arabs believe that if you didn't have a big knot, you know, those little, if you touch the back of your head, there's a little, that's your base of your cranium, but that knot, the bigger it was, the more intelligent you were. So if it was flat, so the Prophet was kind of making light of that. You know, it's like dummy. Come on, dummy. So that period then is the first period, and that there's a khilaf. Some of the ulama say until the shuruq, which is the sunrise, the shuruq would say is here, so the sun rises here. Until the shuruq, this is all mukhtar. That's one opinion. These are both strong opinions. The mukhtar means that you can pray as long as you get your prayer sometime before the sunrise. You have that choice. So if generally in our climb, you're going to see it's about an hour and a half. You have an hour and a half. That's about how long from the first dawn until the sunrise is generally about. And you can work this out just on you know, for people that are good at calculations and things, you can work it on based on the degrees and things like that of where you are. But it's generally going to be an hour and a half. So as the you know, as the sun's moving up and the light becomes discernible, that's the second opinion, that the discernible light, which is the isfar, yusfiru, when things begin to be, so you can clearly distinguish things. So if you see people, you can make out their faces. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's going to be, it's probably going to be, it's usually like maybe 25, 30 minutes into the Fajr, you know? Yeah, I don't know when the actual degree is. You know, it's really interesting. You have to be careful with the astronomical terms. They do say civil twilight, but civil twilight is before the Isfar. You know, I mean, twilight, you know, these are all old terms when people actually could see these things. You have dawn, and then twilight is both ends of the day. The twilight is that light that starts showing up. And it gets to the point where it's civil twilight, which is where, that's about the time we're praying here. At about 5, it's more like the civil twilight. The Isfar is a little after that, to where things are really discernible, but it's not. You've still probably got about 20 minutes before the sun rises, you know.
That's around the time when the street lamps come on and you have to put headlights.
Yeah, no, exactly. And the and exactly, yeah. So, and then, you know, that's the second opinion, is that the time, this time is mukhtar, and then this time is daruri. Daruri is the time where you have to pray. If you don't, it's sinful. All right? So if you leave your prayer into the daruri time, it's sinful. And then the third opinion, which is the strongest opinion that most Malikis follow, is it's all daruri. The Fajr is not really a mukhtar time. That you should pray it as soon as you wake. If the Fajr's in, you should pray it within the time it takes. If, you know, if it's at the masjid, you go to the masjid, or the time it takes to do wudu, to do your two rakats of raghiba, which we'll get into when we get into the nawafil, and then pray that time. So those are the opinions about, you know, the mukhtar, the daruri of fajr. Makruh. Well, like I said, I mean, there's difference of opinions. One opinion is it's haram to delay that up till then. That you should be praying in that first time. If you wake up late, you should pray immediately. I mean, the prayer times are all dependent upon your, you know, your niyyah. Like if you're lazy about it, and you're just kind of waiting around. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned that hypocrites were people that waited till, you know, وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قَامُوا كُسَالَ. When they get up to pray, they're lazy about it. In the tafsirs, they say they wait until the last time and then they get up, which is not necessarily a complete hypocrite. You know, you have to remember, hypocrisy is a continuum. So the complete hypocrites don't even believe in Islam. These type hypocrites are people that they do believe in Islam. Like they don't want to lose the prayer time, but they have a nifaq in their faith. You know, it's their faith is just not, because if somebody was there, they wouldn't be doing that, right? So they're more concerned about people than they are about God. So if somebody was there, they'll like, oh, it's time to pray, you know, let's go. Whereas if they're out watching the football game, I'll just wait till the, you know, it's only one more quarter or whatever. Do you see what I mean? So that's a type of nifaq. I mean, nifaq. Mm-hmm. Well, that's just about Fajr. The other, Fajr and Maghrib, because the windows are quite short and they're the easiest prayers to miss, there's more stringent opinions on Fajr and Maghrib. The other prayers are quite lenient. You know, Asr has a shorter window as well. But there's Asr has a reasonable amount of time before it gets into the daruri. Mm-hmm. Yeah?
Does it mean then that
anytime Fajr, you're allowed to have a time? I mean, Fajr, yeah, I tend to, you know, this period is for me, that's like a mukhtar period. If it's dark out, you know, you've got some room. If it starts getting light, you should be concerned. About, you know, I wouldn't wait till it get, till the isfar, to where it's, you know, things are really clearly discernible. Mm-hmm.
If you do wake up late, for whatever reason, and you have to finish the prayer before the sunrise, but what if you're in the...
You have to have one rakat, which means you have to have gone into ruku'a before the sun rises and you're coming out. If you do that, then you've obtained the rakat in the time, and it's not qada. It's actually, you're doing ada. I mean, I'll get into that in a second, okay? So let me finish, because a lot of these questions are going to get answered. So let me just get through this section. Now, sunrise, obviously, is a period, you know, in the Hanafi madhab, you don't pray during the sunrise. In Maliki, if you owe the prayer, you pray. Because the illah for not praying at sunrise is sun worshippers, and it's just not around anymore. I mean, there's probably still sun worshippers, but it's not a problem for the Muslims, you know. So anyway, if you owe the prayer, you pray, even if the sun's coming up. So if the sun hasn't, if it's starting to come up, you see it on the horizon, and you haven't prayed Fajr, you just pray the Subh prayer, all right? And then, when this goes up to the 90 degree point. And now, at the time the fay comes, right? Which, like I said, according to Ibn Arafah, it's 1 degree, which is approximately 4 minutes from the 90 degrees. So that's quite quick, 1 degree. I mean, I wouldn't pray within 1 degree, but most of the prayer schedules, like I said, are based on this principle. It's like immediately after Zawal. So it's 91 degrees. The horse in, all right? But generally, I would give it 20 minutes from Zawal. And If you're Mauritanian up in these parts, they would probably wait 40 minutes. If they're strict, you know, like people that I studied with, they would not pray, although it's clearly past the Zawal. So I'm just letting you know, people aren't, inshallah, all these prayer times are valid. The only thing that I genuinely worry about is, like I said, most of the prayer schedules are based on zones. All right? So they're giving you a geographical region and they're saying that here's your 12 p.m. So it's not true post-meridian. Do you see what I mean? So you actually might be at that early part of the geographical zone. So when you read your prayer time, it's not actually in yet because they're averaging it. So that's the actual true. And so this time is after and this time is slightly before. So depending on where you are, you might be in an area, unless it's a really accurate, and I don't think there are those programs, because all these schedules are based on the Nassau programs. And when I checked, this was several years ago when I was doing this research, the programs were based on averages. So they're problematic. But I did find, like I said, for some reason or another, Asr is incredibly accurate. But we found discrepancies. We measured the Dhuhr every day. We did computer-generated graphs, you know. So we found there was a problem with Dhuhr on the prayer schedules. Mm-hmm.
When I check online for the prayer times, it gives you the option to choose which city you were in, like, you know, Toledo, Ohio, Columbus, Ohio, Indiana.
Yeah.
That those are all part of the same region.
Yeah, they're done. They're averages. They're not. Okay, here's what you can do. Check Houston, Texas, and then check a city, you know, that's nearby Houston, and see if there's any change in the thing. Because, you know, if there's no change at all, that it's an average. Say, you know, if it's 20 miles away and there's no change in the prayer time, you have a problem because the sun, you know, that's a time lag. It takes you a certain amount of time. The sun is you know, the dhuhr at that point, 20 minutes is a considerable amount of time when you're measuring shadows. Do you see what I mean? So their shadow, I mean, it's going to be reasonably close, but it's not going to be exact. You see what I mean? So you're going to have some time lag. And that's the problem with those prayer schedules. And like I said, we measured it. We did it ourselves to see based on, and we found discrepancies on these things. I mean, I had somebody going out every single day and doing computer. So it was very small increments just to see when the shadow stopped and when you know, the istiwa, and then went past the north to, and we found that there were prayer schedules that were still, the shadow was still decreasing, and it was saying that dhuhr was in. Now it's only a few minutes, like I said, but a few minutes is the validity of a prayer or the invalidity of a prayer, because you have to have yaqeen about prayer times. The only time you can have ghalib al-dhan is if it's if the sky is overcast or something like that, then ghalib al-dhan is permissible. You know, where the overwhelming preponderance of evidence, like I said, the craftsmen who say no, dhuhr is definitely in. I mean, they don't have certainty. Now, some of these things you can argue, you know, this is all pre-modern stuff, right? Because now we have all the. But my point is that all this scientific stuff is not as accurate as people think it is. Do you see what I mean? Because it wasn't designed. Had Muslims done it, it probably would be accurate, you know, because they would have designed it with this knowledge in mind. But most of our like engineers never studied fiqh, so they don't even know what, you know, and they don't even understand the average. Most people don't know about any of this stuff. You know, people just follow prayer schedules, calendars. They tell us it's Mawlid, we have Mawlid. They tell us it's Ramadan, we have Ramadan. People don't know anymore. And most of the people doing this stuff don't know. That's my point, is literally they don't know because they didn't study this stuff. Most of the ulama that I studied with the exception of some of the Moroccans and the Mauritanians, have never done any of this. They read the chapter, They never went out and measured shadow. They never did any of this stuff. They, no practical. It's all pure theory. Because they haven't been using this stuff except in places like Sudan or Mauritania, where you still have villages and people don't. Like, I mean, I told you, I was in the Haram of Medina, because there are several Mauritanians that I know in Medina that will not pray the Dhuhr in the Haramain, because they think they pray too early, you know, which I don't agree with. But based on Malik's criterion, it's true. But anyway, so I was measuring inside the Haram one day, the shadow in the Haram Madani, and this guard came up. He said, "What are you doing? Majnun? Are you crazy?" I said, "No, I was measuring the shadow." "What are you measuring the shadow for?" I said, "I was just checking the Dhuhr time." He said, "The guy gave the Adhan. It's Dhuhr." I said, "I know, I just wanted to just to see how close the two were." And then he got really upset, like, "Don't do that." There was some old Bedouin guy who was down there. He said, my father used to do that, to check the Dhuhr, you know. And that's how long ago. But all this stuff, the prayer, you know, Muslims have been using calendars for a long time, but they still learned all the stuff, you know, because the idea, it's like Rasam al-Quran. You can argue, why learn Rasam? Al-Uthmani, because in the East, the Hufad, they don't know Rasam. You memorize Quran without Rasam. In Mauritania, they will not give you an ijazah in Quran without knowing how to write the Quran. That's one of the criterion of a Hafiz, is that if all the mushafs disappeared on the planet, you could write it. Now, you can say, it's, you know, we don't need that, because now we've got millions. King Fahd printed millions of Qurans. They're everywhere. There's not going to be a problem. Well, when people were brought from West Africa to America as slaves, there were people that knew how to write the Quran, even though they were stripped of everything. So you could be end up in Guantanamo Bay or something in an orange suit, and they don't give you a Quran. But if somebody was a hafiz, they could write the whole Quran out with the Rasam al-Uthmani. You know, that could happen. You know, it's not foolproof. So all these things are meant to be preserved. They have to be preserved. And this is what tradition is. It's handing it down. You know, people, the Sahaba were doing this. This is how they were determining their prayer time. They weren't determining it from, they didn't Google, I pray, to find out when the time was. So, now, when you get to the Dhuhr time here, all right, so Dhuhr starts here. Like I said, until the shadow is twice, right here. Until the shadow is twice in the Hanafi, once in the Maliki. So if you're 7 feet and you're 7 feet tall, I mean not 7 feet tall, you have your height is 7 of your feet, and the Fay was 2 feet, then when you get here to 9 feet, that's when the Asr is in, all right? And then the Asr prayer here, when the Asr prayer comes in, that, according to the Maliki Madhab, is the end of Mukhtar time. So this is all Mukhtar. Malik is very generous with prayer times. Because unlike the other madhabs, Imam Malik says that until the sunset, which we'll say is here, until the sunset, this is all daruri. This, at the time Asr comes in here, until sunset, is still daruri time for Dhuhr. So you're not praying qada, you're praying ada. In other words, you're not making up Dhuhr. As long as you prayed Dhuhr in the Asr prayer time, with one rakat of Asr before the sun sets, you've done it ada'an. You've performed it in its time. Now, it's considered itham. You should say astaghfirullah, that you waited to, unless you had like surgery or you were saving a life, or even smudging fruit, you know, is permissible, like to save wealth, it's permissible. Like, if you know orange farmers, when they have a heavy frost, have you ever seen smudge pots? They have these in lemon groves, orange groves, places where they have fruit groves. You'll see little pipes next to the trees. Those are smudge pipes. And what happens is that they heat up. So if they get a heavy frost, the farmers get out there in the morning and they heat the tree up so they can prevent, the loss of the, because frost kills fruit if it's a heavy frost. So the ulama mentioned that it was permissible if you're going to lose your crop, that you could actually delay your fajr to save the property. It's permissible to leave the prayer to save property. Like, you're praying and you realize you didn't put your brake on, your car's about to go over the cliff. You can actually, you might not want to get in your car as it's about to go over a cliff. But if you can save the car, you can actually leave the prayer to save, wealth or life. If it's considerable, if it's tafih, you can't. If it's something, like it's going to crush the baby doll and then come to a stop, you don't go save the baby doll or something, all right? So now the other thing that Malik is very generous in is what's called waqt mushtarak. Malik says that there's three prayer times in the Quran given. The Sunnah gives us five, but the Quran actually gives three, which is why the Quraniyun people, these people that negate hadith, they pray three times a day. And the Shia also have a strong, opinion that you can pray just those three times. Imam Malik said, because the Quran says to pray at ila duruk ash-shams, the duruk ash-shams is the mail of the shams, the movement of the sun, which is dhuhr and asr, right? Wa ghasaq al-layl is the time when the time when maghrib and isha come in, and then wa quran al-fajri, and then pray at fajr. So those are the three times that the Quran gives. There's no dhuhr, asr, maghrib and isha are not mentioned in that way in the Quran. There's only three times. So Imam Malik also took that from the hadith, which is a sahih hadith, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Jibreel came and showed him the prayer times. And on one day he prayed, the man who asked the Prophet to, on one day he prayed at the beginning of the Dhuhr time, the next day he prayed at the end of the Dhuhr time, and said it's between those two. The end of the Dhuhr time is the beginning of Asr time. There's about a 15-minute window where it is permissible and not sinful. It's makruh without a reason, but it's not sinful. It is permitted to join the Dhuhr and Asr. You can actually join the two prayers, and they're both prayed in their time, and it's not considered a sin to do that. Does everybody understand that? No, Asr has to be in, but it's a window of time. It's about 15 minutes when it's called waqt mushtarak, which is where Dhuhr and Asr are considered. It's not daruri yet for Dhuhr, it's still mukhtar at the very beginning of Asr time. If you delay it beyond that, then it's not. And the same is true for Maghrib and Isha. If you delay Maghrib up to the very end of Maghrib, because Maghrib, unlike the Hanafi madhab, which says you have to wait till the white is out, because they differ on the ghasaq, whether it's the ihmirar, the red, or is it the white light, the twilight, right? So dusk is the light that, the red light, the dusk from dawn to dusk. Dusk is the light that appears at the beginning of Maghrib up to the twilight, where it's red and yellow and all kinds. The last color you see is green. It's the first color you see in the morning. It's called the green phenomenon. If you're ever at an ocean and you watch the sunset, pray Maghrib, You can sit and watch, and as the last light goes before the twilight, you'll see a green flash. It's quite extraordinary to watch it. Any questions about any of the? Mm-hmm.
So the Mukhtar time for Dhuhr mm-hmm. is 15 minutes. I'm just saying it back so I know if I'm wrong. 15 minutes after the Asr comes in, it's still Mukhtar time.
I mean, I wouldn't fix it at 15 minutes. It's just around that. It's enough time to pray Dhuhr at the beginning of Asr time. Do you know? And then pray Asr. So you've got that period. You know, an average prayer is going to take you maybe, 8 minutes. If you have to do wudu and then you go pray, it'll take about 8 minutes. So the two prayers, there's that time at the beginning of Asr, right? Or the very end of Dhuhr, right before Asr begins, so that you pray Dhuhr, your 4 rakats, and then Asr comes in and you pray Asr, you can actually join them. Do you see? That's the point. And that period is it's a shared period of Dhuhr and Asr. They can be combined, and it's makruh. It's not haram. Karahiyah is, I wouldn't belittle karahiyah. It's not like a light thing. Oh, it's just makruh. But it is important to remember, it's not sinful. Makruh is not sinful. You haven't done anything wrong. It's moving into daruri. It's still mukhtar. If you delay it to that point, you're in the mukhtar time. That's my point. If you delay it beyond that, it's daruri. And because the window is so narrow, it's just something you don't want to do unless there's a real reason to do it. I wouldn't, like Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayya said, there's certain people that have jobs that are very, it's very difficult to pray Dhuhr and Asr. And so he said it's a rukhsa, to do that. However, I was a critical care nurse working in, an intensive care unit. And I prayed, I had the 3 to 11 shift. So I had Asr, Maghrib, and Isha. And I always prayed them on time. So, and I think that's about as intense a job as you're going to get with, I just don't buy it when people tell me, I have this job and I can't, it's usually they're ashamed and it's hard for them to openly pray or something like that. It's like the guy in the janitor's room who goes and prays. And when the janitor opens up, he starts doing the push-ups, I mean, people should be ashamed not to pray. Alhamdulillah. I mean, I used to pray years ago, because we went to college together. I'd pray right out in the open on the college campus. I had a Christian come up to me once and said, watching you pray your prayer, it's really given that, like, we... I don't know why Christians are so ashamed not to pray in public. Like, he was encouraged by it, so. I mean, if prayer comes, I've prayed on the side of the road, on the freeway. My wife was with me once. Asr time was getting into that daruri time, and I pulled over, and it was like one of those really heavy freeways. And I started praying, and this cop stops. Sir, what are you doing? I thought he was going to shoot me. I was thinking, I'll be a martyr for Asr prayer. But I mean, I was literally in ruku'ah. Sir, are you all right? Are you? So when I finished the prayer, I went over there and just told him I had to pray. And because the sun, if it goes down, I lose my prayer. And he said, well, you can't do it here, But prayer times, just to give you the enormity of losing a prayer time, in Maliki Fiqh, if you believe that you will miss a prayer by going to Hajj, Hajj is not an obligation. And that's mentioned in all the Maliki books of fiqh in Bab al-Hajj. If you think you'll miss one prayer, and you have ghalib al-dhan, you know, the high probability, then the Hajj is not an obligation. So that just tells you how important the prayer time is, you know. Mm-hmm. Airplanes. I mean, it's a problem, you know. Generally, like with, there's two ways you can do it. You can do it based on the hadith about the prayer time. The Prophet ﷺ said in the towards the end of time, a week would be like a day, and a day would be like an hour. And the Prophet ﷺ said, how should we pray? Should we pray in the normal time? He said, فَقْدُرُ لَهُ, you know, estimate it. Now, if you're traveling on a jet plane, a day can be like an hour. You know, you can the prayer times, if you're going towards the east, they really shorten up. So there's two ways that you can do it. One is to do it based on your point of departure and pray the times of the points of departure, right? And the other is to just hasten the prayer times up. Mm-hmm.
If in Maliki you can do Jama, then that would be easier. You don't have to worry about two separate prayer times.
Well, I mean, I'll give you an example. If you pray, if you're going over the Great Circle route over the north, Isha, you know, Fajr just comes like, it comes so fast. And you can lose it really quick because the sun rises also. So unless you're really hyper-vigilant, like I've missed Fajr because I've done that flight many times. Unless you're really hyper-vigilant, you can do it. So it's a problem. That's all I'm saying. I mean, I have arrived at Heathrow. You know, it gets in about 7 in the morning, that flight. And, you know, it's hard to pray sometimes because you fall asleep and then you wake up and you're preparing to land, you know. So, you know, prayers make it a problem. You know, I'd like to see travel going back to trains and boats, some more civilized way of traveling. Mm-hmm. No, subh, fajr is the phenomenon, the break of dawn. Subh is the morning. The fajr prayer is what we call raghiba. It's higher than a sunnah, lower than mu'akkada in Maliki. He's the only imam that has raghiba. It's not sunnah mu'akkada, but it's not a nafila either. It's higher. And that's the two prayers that you pray once the first light has shown up in dawn. That's called fajr prayer. But we also, urfan, we, you know, just conventionally, we call the subh prayer, fajr prayer. Have you prayed fajr? And they mean the fard. In technical vocabulary, it's not really accurate. It's like calling the nafida sunnah. It's the same thing. But these are just, you know, ammat al-nas, general people use these terms differently from the way the fuqaha use them. So subh prayer is the fard prayer in the morning before the sun rises. If the disk has shown up on the horizon, then the subh time is now gone. And you have to pray qada. And I'm going to get into qada when I get into the prayers. Okay. But I'm saying in the Maliki Madhab, qada is very generous. Ada. You know, he gives you a lot of room to pray ada. All right. Mm-hmm. Anything else? Somebody had a question? Yeah.
Just to clarify, in the first opinion, if I'm leaving from Newark to Dubai,
mm-hmm.
should I just pray according to Newark's time using the Newark clock?
What I do generally, if I'm worried about it, is I do it that way, and then I make up the prayers later. Yeah, just ihtiyatan. Yeah. If I think I'm going to miss it, I pray the prayer according to the time I left, So I do Maghrib, I do Isha, right? And then later, you know, I'll do, when you're going back west, it's nice. Cause then there's like 20 hours between Dhuhr and Fajr, you know. But when you're going the other way, it's hard. So if I wake up, I wake up. If I don't, then I pray it on my point of origins time.
But regardless of what you see outside your window, Blaine.
Yeah.
Like,
no, if you see the light, you can pray. Yeah, because these are asbab. You know, it's a sabab. Once you see that Fajr light, it's Fajr. It doesn't matter if it took an hour to get that between Isha and Fajr. Yeah, it's a sabab to enter into the prayer. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Playing time is the only problem that I found. It definitely creates a problem, you know. It depends. I mean, we're gonna get to that. But when you you can have jam'u taqdim, which is to bring the asr forward to the dhuhr time, or you can have jam'u ta'khir, and that depends on where you are and where you'll be, and if you're in sayr or not, if you're actually in movement. Because unlike Shafi'i has jam'u al-mutlaq. You know, if you're traveling, you can join prayers irrespective of movement. Maliki stipulates movement to join. You can't join once you've alighted in a hotel or you're at a house and you're going to stay there for a day. You can't join. Shafi'i, you can. Maliki, you can't. Maliki stipulates that you're actually in movement, that the bringing the prayer forward or delaying it is a rukhsa due to the difficulty of movement. Now, you can do waqt mushtarak, though, if you wanted. If you're staying at somebody's house, if you want. But and now with the iPray and stuff, you can get the times accurately, and you've got your watch, you can do that. Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayya is more lenient on that because of modern travel, that it's, you know, it's actually harder in a lot of ways than earlier travel. I've done both, because I've done pre-modern travel. When I was in West Africa, I traveled pre-modern. I walked, you know, 45 miles, I've rode camel, you know, I mean, I did traditional traveling, so I know the difference. And I actually think in a lot of ways, the modern travel is more, you know, it's just harder. I think it's actually harder on your body in some ways. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. No, you would have, if you're going to get there after Isha time, and that's ghalib al-dhan, the high probability. You could have a flat tire, a lot of things can happen. But all that aside, you can join, if I'm here in Pearlstone, and I'm going to Adams Center, and it's mid Dhuhr time, and I have a stop on the way, and I know I'm going to get there after Asr or in the daruri time of Asr, then I can bring Asr forward. But if my ghalib al-dhan, right, what I think most likely will happen is I will get to Adams at the beginning of Asr time, then according to Malik, you should not join. You should pray the Asr there, even if it's two rakats. You could still be traveling, but you should pray the two rakats. My experience with modern travel, I tend to incline toward Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayya's position. If you're in that, the Shafi'i madhab rukhsa is, you know, it's definitely tatabbu' rukhsa, but, it, you know, my experience is it's easy to miss your prayers. We don't have masajid everywhere. There's just a lot of variables, and so I tend to be more personally lenient on that position. And I know a lot of Hanafis that do that as well, you know, because in the end they're valid opinions, and the most important thing is that you pray on time and validly. But anything else? So uh, So now let me just do from Maghrib, all right, until Fajr. Okay, so here's Maghrib. And here's Fajr.
So Asr is all Mukhtar time in the beginning?
No, Asr is Mukhtar time until what's called the Isfirar. Isfirar is again a problematic term, all right? Because it depends a lot on your location. In certain areas, all right, the okay, the isfirar is late afternoon yellowing, a change that occurs in the sunlight's hue, in which a noted yellowing occurs on the earth and on the walls of buildings. However, these are not uniform criteria as hues change. So, you know, you can tell in the afternoon, there's a beautiful Emily Dickinson poem about that slant of light in the late afternoon. There's a change in light. And people that are sensitive to this are photographers. Because photographers know the apertures. You know, most people just are oblivious to a lot of these natural phenomena that are happening. But Ibn Abi Zayd says that if you're looking straight ahead and you can see the orb of the sun, then the daruri time of Asr has come in. But that's based on him living in Tunisia. That's not going to be the case. If you're in Alaska, you're always going to see the orb of the sun. So, you know, criterion differ about this. But generally, the time of Asr is, you know, it's like, what's Asr now, right now? It comes in at 6, and Maghrib's at 8:40. So you've got about two hours and 40 minutes, all right? The daruri time of Asr is going to be after about an hour and 40 minutes. Okay, so that's early. Yeah, and then so 5:07. So you've got 3 hours, right, and 40 minutes until Maghrib. Is that right? 8:20. So 3 hours and 20 minutes, approximately, right? So that's about right. You know, so it'll be like an hour and a half into Maghrib, you know, because that's about right. You usually get around 3 hours with Asr, you get around 3 hours with Dhuhr. And so there's a lot of time. You know, that time is a generous time. Mm-hmm.
I leave the Asr prayer here, but I'm a Hanafi, so maybe Asr time when that's entered yet. Does that make it problematic?
No, because the Hanafi have two opinions that are both strong. You know, the Hanafis have an opinion that it begins at the same time as the
both Abu Yusuf and Muhammad and Imam Tahawi are with
Mithlay. Yeah, Mithlay. Yeah, exactly. It's a strong opinion. So they're both valid opinions. You know, I mean, so Rahma, you know, people always use a case against the madhab. How many people have heard the argument that it got so bad they had 4 mihrabs at the Kaaba? How many have heard that argument? That is a complete lie and a slander of this ummah. You know, it really bothers me that they put that out there. They never had, they only had 1 mihrab in Medina. Only one. Same people, same rulers, everything. The reason they had 4 mihrab was to honor the madhabs. And because the prayer times are different, so it allowed people to come to the Kaaba and they could catch the prayer. And I'll give you an example. I was in Al-Ahsa where they have all 4 madhabs. And they have families that follow the madhabs. So like the Mubarak family is a Maliki family in Al-Ahsa. This is in eastern Saudi Arabia. And then you have like the Arfaj family is a Shafi'i family. The Mullah family is a Hanafi family. I mean, these are whole clans. They're not like families like we think. This is like hundreds of people. And so one morning we woke up a little late to go to pray the Fajr prayer. And I was in the house of the Dogan family. And they're Shafi'i. And they have a masjid right outside. But anyway, we got up late. I was with Sheikh Abdullah Al-Qadi. So they said, let's go to the Hanafi masjid. because they haven't prayed yet. So we went and we prayed Fajr in Jama'ah, in the masjid, in the Hanafi masjid, and it was such a rahmah, you know, and nobody was like, oh, we can't pray with the Hanafis, a'udhu billah, you know. I mean, it's just a slander against the ummah, you know, to say that somehow that they had those four mihrab because there was ta'asub. They were all friends, they were all people that respected and knew each other, the ulama all knew each other, you know. It was pre-microphone too. You know, seriously. I mean, there wasn't microphone, so you didn't. You used to have a musammi', which is the person who would, the imam would say Allahu Akbar, and then about 10 rows down, the musammi' would say Allahu Akbar, and then 10 more down. So it goes. So people, that's how they did it, pre-microphone. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I was saying. It's the isfirar time is relative. Even the shadows are going to be relative to where you are. So, but that, so Maghrib, once Maghrib comes in, and astronomical Maghrib is when the sun is halfway down. So if you look in the newspapers and it says sunset, that's what they mean. So you can't follow, you have to give it a couple of minutes from the newspapers. And then you have up to the Shafaq al-Ahmar when it disappears, right? Which is, it's a reddening in the sky. So when that disappears, the twilight begins. And the twilight's going to last for a period of time, depending on where you are. In England, the twilight will last until Fajr. If you're in extremely northerly climates in England, and so these poor Hanafi people are stuck up there, you know, they can't break their fast until Fajr, and by the time they can break their fast, they have to start the fast for the next day, so they lose a lot of weight during Ramadan. Yeah, they just drop dead. And, yeah. So that period here, that most Malikis say that it's daruri, it's not Mukhtar. Some say up to the Shafaq is Mukhtar. And then Malik says all the way up to right before Fajr, in which you can pray one rakat of Isha, is the daruri of Maghrib. So Maghrib prayer in the Maliki Madhab goes all the way up to right before Fajr, unlike the other Madhabs. So if you, now, here's another way to do this. In traditional cosmology, you have 12 hours of the day and 12 hours of the night. So you know how they talk about the last third of the night, right? The best time to get up. This is based on the hours of the night. Sa'at al-layl wa sa'at al-nahar. In the Arabic language, there are 12 hours of night, 12 hours of day. But time in this cosmology is relative. So the hours change. Sometimes the hour is a half an hour of our modern time. All right? The times don't change. In classical Islamic understanding, there were always 12 hours of the day and 12 hours of the night, but they change in their time, all right? So, for instance, if sunset is at 6 a.m., sunrise, and Maghrib is at 6 p.m., that is an equinox. Night and day are equal, equinox, equal night to day, all right? When you get to the solstice, you're going to have the most extreme. So summer solstice, longest day. Winter solstice, shortest day. But the 12 hours of the night and the 12 hours of the day in our system have not changed. So if you have, this would mean when you say, for instance, that you should pray the Isha prayer should be prayed by the first third of the night. So you divide the 12 hours, so 4 hours is going to be a third. So the night is divided into these thirds, right? So this is 4 hours, this is 4 hours, and this is 4 hours. Got it? And that those are your thirds of the night. So when they talk about the last third of the night, which is a blessed time, it means the last 4 hours. But they're not 4 hours that are 60 minutes. They're 4 hours. That's why the Salaf said, "Ashita Rabi al-Mu'min." Shita is the spring of the believer, because the days are short to fast, the hours of the day are short to fast, and the hours of the night are long. So that's, in the winter you get the biggest third of the night. That's the longest time you have, do you see? So you get more of that blessed time than you do in the summer. You following this? I always get confused. What's that? The night starts at Maghrib. And there are 12 hours every night, irrespective of whether or not they are 60 minutes. They are 60 minutes when you have the equinox, right? In September and March. September 21st, March 21st, they're 60 minutes. Mm-hmm.
So you just take the...
I'm going to show you how to do it. Yeah. So here, Isha then goes up to the first third of the night after the Shafaq is gone. So if the Shafaq will usually take about an hour and 20 minutes, something like that. Like right now, what time is Maghrib is at 8:20. What time does Isha come in? Okay, so that's an hour and 10, 8:20, huh? It's an hour and 40 minutes, right? No, an hour and 32 minutes. Okay, so that's about right. I mean, if you live in this area, like we're, what, does anybody know what degree this is? The latitude? I'm in 38. You should know your degree. It's a useful thing to know. Yeah. No, it's not. We'd be in Canada. But anyway, it's probably, I think it's probably maybe 30, it's around 39 probably, somewhere around there.
Yeah, 39.
Okay. I mean, it's useful to know this stuff. Like I can work it out. Yeah, there. Okay. So it's useful to know these things because you can work out important things, all right? So, here we're 39 degrees. So what that means is that the Isha is generally going to be about an hour and a half between Maghrib and Isha, all right? That means that the Shafaq takes an hour and a half. So here's your hour and a half gets out. And then Isha comes in at that point. So here it comes in at what time? 9:52, okay? So this is 8:20. Okay, so that was 1 hour and 32 minutes. Now, what's going to be then, what time is Fajr here?
4:37.
Okay, 4:37. So, okay, so from 8:20 to 4:37, so how many hours is that? It's... Okay, 8 hours and 17 minutes. 8 hours, and let's round it off to 8 hours and 20 minutes. So 8 hours and 20 minutes, divide that by four. Three. Get your 4 hours. Yeah, your 12 hours. So you're going to divide that by 12. How much? Does anybody have a calculator? No, it should be that you're going to have opposite.
What are we dividing by 12?
Yeah, 8:20 divided by 12.
8 hours and 20 minutes?
Yeah, 8 hours and 20 minutes. It's going to be point something. Yeah, okay. Is that Is that right? 48? Is that right? Okay. It doesn't seem right. It's 43 minutes, an hour. That's it should be around 43. So yeah. So 43, so each hour is 43 minutes of the 12. So if you multiply, what's 12 times 43 then? That should get it.
5:16.
Yes, and then so you add that the two together and you should get.
That's 500 minutes and we got 5:16, so we're just a little bit off.
Okay.
Yeah, 5:16, 8:6.
There's an easier way to do this. I'm just, my mentation's a little slow right now. So you got the point. It's about 43 minutes. So if you want to find out, then, you know, each one of these is four, right? 4 hours, but each hour is 43 minutes. Do you got it? Yeah. It's interesting, huh?
We should call them units instead of hours.
Well, no, they are sa'a, though. They're hours. They're not units. They're sa'a. 60-minute hours is a, that's just an arbitrary, it's just an arbitrary thing. This makes more sense. Exactly. And that's why hour in Arabic means, it can mean a moment. Like qama min sa'atihi. He got up immediately. So the sa'a, the hour, is a relative term. That's the whole point of all this. All right. So if you take this then, if we're 8 hours and 20 minutes, what's one third of that would be 3 hours and what?
3 hours and 12 minutes.
3 hours and 12 minutes. Yeah. So from 8:20 to 3 hours and 12 minutes. So you're going to get at 11, 11:32, now you're into the end of your mukhtar of Isha. Got it? No, you do determine the beginning by the phenomenological sign, but the time that the daruri comes out is done by the third. All right? So, and there's an opinion the first half. So that would be at 4 hours and 10 minutes. That's the second opinion, which would mean from 8:20. So you'd go up already into 12:20, right? Like that. So you could do, it just depends on which method you're using. Okay, but the one first third is generally the dominant opinion. So does everybody follow that? So from 9:52 to 8:32 is your mukhtar time of Isha. If you prayed it, it's small because we're in the summer. It's going to be bigger, right? When you go into the winter, it gets really big. Because the hours expand. When you're in that, when you get to a point where you get an hour and 20 minutes is an hour in the winter, or an hour and 30 minutes. So you're getting double the time. Uh-huh. It's very confusing. So, but I mean, it's not, if you're, there's a simpler way to do this, you know, and, but anyway, but most of you, I think, got it. If you didn't, you know. Uh-huh.
For the shafaq, I thought it was when the red disappears. And so I thought that time would be shorter than what we'd like to be. I thought the meditation came in earlier than when the full twilight disappears.
It does.
So it's more like 45 minutes.
No.
No, I mean, not exactly. But
no, the shafaq takes a while to go.
What's the sign for Isha coming in?
The end of the red.
So the end of the shafaq.
Yeah. Now that might be following the twilight. and that might be the problem. Do you see? They might not be doing that. That might be Hanafi, because most of these things have been done by Hanafis. Yeah. So that's true. That's a good point. Because they the Hanafis rule. Yeah.
It'd be interesting if like you can do this on like an Excel sheet, do a formula.
Oh, it'd be easy to do. I'm waiting for somebody to do it. Why don't you do it? Yeah. Because it's worth doing, you know, it's worth having this stuff. And this is really interesting stuff to me. It's just fascinating. I haven't looked at it in a while, you know, but I really got into it for a period of time and just, you know, and it's nice to know. It's just such useful. Fiqh is a really relieving thing, because if you know your fiqh, you just don't get confused like everybody else. I mean, Muslims are confused because they stopped studying fiqh. Really, all the problems in marriage is because they didn't study fiqh of marriage. It's all solved in there. 90%, if people were really committed to actually practicing this religion, 90% of their problems would go. But they're not committed to it. I mean, there's very clear things about, like in fiqh, about male and female. And to be honest with you, most of it sides on the female side. So it's not like, I mean, there are certain things that are definitely male-centric. But there are a lot of the family rulings are on the side of the women. It's really like the men are the ones that are the losers on many of the situations, which I think might be the reason why the men stopped teaching the women fiqh, you know, because it's like, it could get really difficult. Cook your own dinner. Honey. So, anyway, there you go. So that's it. So if you want to know that for here, this period is going to be the last 3 hours before. So now, if the Fajr is, you know, if it's at 6 o'clock, then obviously it's going to be 6 p.m. You get those 4 hours, all right, from that time that you start. So two in the morning till six is going to be that time when there's more blessing. It gets shorter, like I said, in the summer it's shorter because you're only getting 43 minutes out of your hour. And then in the winter you're getting like an hour and 20 minutes, so it gets longer. That's why winter's, it's a very blessed time for people that are into ibadah. For that reason, it's short fasting and long at night. All right? So that's pretty much the prayer times that I can think of. Is there any other? Well, also, what's that? Oh, it's a class. Okay.
They have a Italian unit in North America during the summer.
What's that? Qabada Sama. We don't, like in the Hanafi, the Istiwa.
No, I mean, at night time during the summer. Do you have a time where the Shafaq just remains for like the whole night?
Not here. Mm-mm. But there are places where that's true. If you're in an extremely southerly or northerly climate, you'll get the red glow for a long, long time because the sun's so low on the horizon. Mm-hmm. This is it's called the Helping Guide. Soon to be available at your Romi bookstore. Yeah. You know, it's alhamdulillah. It's pretty much got all the ibadat in it. It has a lot of nice charts and so. Yeah, no, it's a lot. I mean, this is all somebody would need for ibadat to do the five pillars, and then it's got a few other things in there that are useful. Uh huh. Well, you know, I mean, I'm trying to
to just have things that are like the Tahawiyyah. You know, that took a long time, but if you go through it, you'll find that there aren't mistakes in there, and it's a critical Arabic edition. You know, the language, it just takes time to do something well, and then so I'm not going to say, because this should have been out. I thought it was going to be out a while ago, but it hasn't. So I'd just rather, inshallah, when it gets done, it gets done. We're trying to do it. You all can beat up Uzma too, because she's part of the project. But we're trying, because the Malikis, we don't have any real text yet in English, which is unfortunate. You know, even our texts in Arabic are terrible. Really, the Shafi'i madhab and the Shafi'i and the Hanafi madhab are much better served than the Maliki. Shafi'i because of the Syrians, and the Hanafis because there's so many of them. So it's just like, you have a lot of Hanafi people doing Hanafi stuff. Mm-hmm. This is all ibadat. Yeah. I mean, that's, you know, this is a series. You know, we're trying to do that. Like the, you know, I mean, a lot of this stuff would have been, it'd be a lot easier if there was, you know, support from, there's a lot of small support, you know, but you need institutions. I mean, the Christians have huge institutions, you know. I mean, look what they do, huh, David? Right? You were at Princeton, right? I mean, look what they can do there, you know, all the research, all the, you know. And Princeton University Press is one of my models. We use the same printer that they do. You know, because that's what I want to see Islam at that level. I want to see us at the level of Princeton and Harvard. And our materials, our religion should be competing at that level of excellence. You know, I mean, I hate all this rubbish stuff. I just would rather have it burnt. I really mean it. You know, we're living in a time, I mean, it was fine in pre-modern periods. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's letters are beautiful because that reflects their, you know, and people made fun of them. That's true, you know, like the, but the Muslims learned very quickly. And before long, they had so far outstripped all the previous empires in their excellence and beauty that everybody was in awe of them. And we don't have that anymore, you know. So that's where we need to get back as a community. You know, we need to get back to that our religion is awe-inspiring. But that takes, you know, it takes a commitment to excellence and itqan, and inna Allah yuhibbu al-'abda idha 'amila 'amalan an yutqinahu. Allah loves a servant that if he does something, he does it with excellence, with itqan, you know, real itqan in action. And that's why itqan is a beautiful thing. That's why, I mean, this culture is mesmerized by itqan. You know, Michael Jackson is, you know, he's mesmerizing because he could do something. It's a silly thing, but he could do it better than anybody else. And so people, they'll pay money to see that. And that's what they're really into. They're not into, they're into like, how does he do that? Well, he did it by practicing 8 hours a day. You know, but people don't see that. They just see the end result, and then they think it's magical. It's not magical. It's just really hard work and talent. I mean, you need talent. There's no doubt about that. That's the extra factor, which is why he was at the top of his field, because he had a massive amount of talent. But that's true of anything, whether it's music, sports. I mean, people are paying all that money to watch these guys because they can throw a basket from a place that if you try to do it, you won't get it every time you do it, but they get it most of the time they do it. And the more they get it, the more higher they are paid, and the more people want to watch them. But all they're really wanting to see is that itqan. That's what mesmerizes them. It's a waste of, I mean, one of my favorite stories is that Harun al-Rashid had a majlis where people used to come in and do, you know, it was kind of like a gong show or something. It was, people used to come in and do things to amuse him. And if he liked them, he would reward them. And if he didn't, he would. But one man could take, you know, old pre-modern needles were quite big, but he could take needles and throw a needle through the eye of the other needle, and he could do this like consistently. And so he did it, you know. And Harun al-Rashid had ordered to have him, he got 10 lashes and 40 dinars. and the man didn't understand it, and he asked him to explain why he was punishing him and rewarding him. And he said, the reward is for the itqan, but the punishment is for the time wasted in mastering what you've mastered. You know, so itqan is, it's an amazing thing, no matter what it is. That's why it's always amazing to see it. All right, Maliki people.